Okay, great. We're going to get started. Welcome everyone to the NJDEP Vapor Intrusion Technical Guidance Training. This morning we have experienced a little bit of technical difficulty, but I think we're back on track. You might have noticed us checking everything. One thing we are missing is one of the presenters. He happens to be stuck on the turnpike right now, but we're expecting him any minute. And so if he does not join, John will cover his section. That's Brian Blum, who's stuck right now. John will cover his section, but Brian will join us as soon as he is able. So first off, I'd like to welcome everyone on the web. We do have, we're broadcasting live from NJDEP Studios in Trenton on the wonderful sixth floor main conference room. We do have some DEP staff in the room, and we also know that we have a significant number of people on the webinar. Today, the way we'll handle questions is that if they are questions from the room, we'll have the presenters repeat the questions just so that everyone on the webinar can hear them, and as well as the answers. If there's any trouble with the audio, feel free to let us know via the web. We'll try to fix that. So far, there are our calibrations. Hopefully, everything is working correctly. So first of all, my name is George Nicholas. I'm a geologist with the New Jersey DEP's Bureau of Groundwater Pollution Assessment. I'm also the chairperson and oversee the work of the technical guidance committees, as well as I work with the NJDEP's site remediation program training program, which is one of the reasons why we were able to put on these training sessions today. I just wanted to give you some background on the guidance committees and how they operate. The guidance committees, they're depending on size, composed of 2 to 3 DEP staff, 3 to 7 stakeholders. And they're really selected to create a balance of technical expertise, regulatory knowledge, and practical application. They're also chaired by a DEP representative, and we have a representative from my group, Technical Guidance Oversight, participates on the teams just to answer questions and make sure progress is maintained. Their tasks are pretty simple, to develop a technical guidance document, and also to work with the training program to develop a training class, which is why we're here today. Also, the documents, we anticipate if revisions are necessary, they'll be in response to changes in regulations and or advances in technology. To give you an idea of what the review process was, in the very beginning, we realized that the technical guidance documents did needed to have a robust review process, but we really needed to balance that, the need for good feedback with the potential for crippling the process if we had an unmanageable number of comments. Actually, the BI document is a good example of that. They almost were crippled, but they got through that. They had over 800 comments, but they did get through that. If we had opened this up to a potentially broader audience, there's a chance that we would not have had the ability to respond to the comments and actually issue the document. So we think that the current process that we have is a good one. That consists of internal review by site remediation management and interested site remediation program staff. We also provide the documents to all the stakeholders on every one of the DEP technical guidance committees, and we ask each one of those stakeholders to coordinate a review within their respective constituency groups. They then funnel all those comments back to the committee chair. In addition to that, we ask the site remediation program steering committee to also review the document to identify any fatal flaws that may prevent the document being used by the regulated community. This is a list of the technical guidance documents that are completed. We're in the process of achieving that goal. Currently, we have 13 finalized documents that are posted on the DEP's webpage at the web address located on the, or identified at the bottom of the slide. The next document to be released will be the monitored natural attenuation document. We anticipate that being posted this Thursday. This is upcoming training sessions, actually including today's training session. Please note, we had scheduled originally preliminary assessment for Wednesday, February 29th. However, that has been postponed due to the March 1st deadline. We had very little registration for that. We think it's an important class, so we decided to actually hook that up with the monitored natural attenuation training on March 6th. So we will combine both of those trainings, preliminary assessment and monitored natural attenuation, on March 6th. So sorry for anybody who that might pose a problem to, but clearly there was a lot of requests for us to do that so that people who are burdened with making the March 1st deadline could participate on March 6th. For some topics such as QAQC and analytical, the topic subject matter is requiring a little bit more time for those. We have those as TBDs for to be determined. When we figure out the schedule of those dates, we will notify everyone. Also, the department's training program, there's a web address down there where you can find more information. We encourage you to access that information. In the very beginning, when technical guidance documents were first issued, there was a link that identified, described the process for obtaining a variance and also from deviating from guidance. One of the issues is that the current tech regs handles variation from rule as well as variation from guidance as the same thing, and that posed a problem. We did not anticipate that the LSRP program back then, and therefore what we wanted to do was identify how the DEP will handle variation or variance from rule as well as deviating from technical guidance. Since we will be handling them differently, this policy paper just identifies what the DEP will do in the interim period between now and when the new rules are adopted. Just really defines the process. Also describes a little bit about the use of professional judgment, which is the next slide. And I just wanted to identify that this policy paper does allow the use of professional judgment. However, when technical guidance isn't used, such as in the case of there is no DEP guidance or the DEP guidance is not considered appropriate, additional guidance could be used. However, it's important that LSRPs let the department know why. This is probably really important for a couple reasons. The first is that the DEP, if we review those documents, it's important for us not to hold up the case or an issuance of an RAO by understanding what was done at the site and why. In addition to that, it's also important for LSRPs when we take over a case. They need to know what was previously done at that site and how it impacts the work they're now going to undertake. And again, the complexity of any explanation is relative to the complexity of the site. One thing that the department's very interested in is feedback. We would like some feedback from practitioners, regulated community, as well as DEP staff as well, on the document usability, problems that may be encountered, suggested updates for the documents, and also new topics for guidance. There's a feedback link on the DEP website at this web address. We would encourage and request that anybody who has feedback to provide to the department that they do so following this link. We certainly take that serious, and we'll take it into consideration. If you could, make sure that you identify what topic it is. If it's guidance related, that will go to me, and I will make sure that the questions or the suggestions are taken into account. Okay, that's it. And actually, we're not going to do entertain questions right now. I think that was pretty basic. We're going to move right into the next presentation, which will be John Boyer. Let's bring it down to the bottom. Should we bring it all the way down to the bottom? Again, technical difficulties will be with you shortly. Great. Excellent. So we'll turn it over to John now.
Thank you, George. Good morning, everyone. One of the interesting things about the vapor intrusion pathway is that it's been the most heavily attended training that the department has given over the last year. And I think in part that's because of the complex nature of the pathway, the unique nature of the pathway. Let me give you an example of why that is and some of the problems that we run into. You're going to have to advance it. As part of my job, I probably get at least a half a dozen phone calls a day from LSRPs who have questions about the document, questions about the vapor intrusion technical guidance itself. And what I've done here is put together a couple questions that I have received and some of the responses that resulted from it. First of all, Yep, actually, I have to go back. George, if you can go back. go back a slide, I would appreciate it. There you go. So this is based on several phone calls I got from the LSRPs. In this case, a petroleum hydrocarbon case that they were investigating. Soil and groundwater samples were collected at a large warehouse, and indoor air results were above the rapid action levels. So I'm being asked by the LSRP on these phone calls, who reports the immediate environmental concern, which, if you're above the rapid action level, warrants notification. And then, when do I get involved in the case? This is the LSRP speaking. So, of course, we need to get a little more information. I'm usually asking additional questions. And as a result of that, I come to find out that the warehouse that was investigated turns out to be over 400 feet from the edge of the plume. This is petroleum hydrocarbons, and he's looking 400 feet away. The warehouse happens to use petroleum hydrocarbons in their process, which complicates the issue. The soil gas, the subslab soil gas results were ND. The RAL exceedance wasn't even for a contaminant of concern associated with the site. And the LSRP was using his firm to do the investigation, but he himself was not involved in it. When I asked him about that, he said, well, that way it won't be my fault if they screw up. So, you know, when you get questions like this, you realize the complexity of the pathway and why it's very important to conduct training. This is the basis of our training, the vapor intrusion technical guidance. You'll notice that the document has a different name, not our choice. Management told us we had to throw the word technical in there. So instead of it being the VIG, which we're all familiar with, we're used to that acronym, now we have to call it the VIT guidance. Doesn't flow quite as well, but so be it. No, not a silent T. The peanut gallery was speaking up there. And the link down below gives you an opportunity to pull up the document if you haven't already. You can utilize the website to get that, or like me, you could probably print out a copy of it. This is our schedule for the next 3.5 hours. We're going to start with an introduction, move on to the VI framework, the mechanism for moving through the process. We'll talk about receptor evaluation, which we consider the first real stage of the process you go through with vapor intrusion. Move on to investigation. We'll take a short break at that point. We'll open up to questions just before the break. When we come back from break, we'll be talking about multiple lines of evidence and data evaluation. Move on to petroleum hydrocarbons and their unique role in vapor intrusion. Next, third stage, mitigation. When you realize you have to do something and the steps you need to take. And then finally, OM&M, which is stage 4, and hopefully you'll reach that point where you can terminate and shut down. That's stage 5. I wanted to acknowledge the members of the committee who served for 20 months working on this document. It's a big document, very complex, lots of issues. And these people need to be acknowledged for the incredible amount of time and effort that they put into it. I've highlighted all the outside stakeholders who were involved in the committee. They got a lot of grief from certain people about their efforts, but I have nothing but praise for the hard work they did, the dedication, and I can't say enough about them. So, if you can't reach me, reach out to some of these people. They're very knowledgeable on the subject and contributed greatly to the document. The history of the committee, well, like I said, 20 months it took us to get this document done. We were formed in May of 2010. We had meetings beginning in June of that year, and frequently those meetings were held every 2 weeks, anywhere from 2 to 4 hours. So you can see the amount of time and effort that went into this. We had a draft come out of the VIT guidance in May of 2011. We had a comment period of 6 weeks, which ended on June 23rd. And then the final document came out on, of all days, Friday the 13th, January of 2012. Summary of the guidance, and particularly the comments. George alluded to the number of comments. We got nearly 800. I think that was almost double the next closest technical guidance. We received that just from 26 individuals and organizations. Thank you, George, for limiting it to what you did, or else we'd still be working on the document. We did do a response to comments. It's 70 pages long with over 597 comments that we responded to. The difference in numbers is because we had quite a few editorial comments. We just didn't seem to be able to spell the word shall properly, and we're called to task on that. And there was a number of editorial or duplicate comments that we received. So when we pared that all down, we came up with just short of 600. The final document, when we looked at the comments, we realized there was a lot of excellent comments that we had received. And we needed to make some changes to the document to reflect the good points that were brought forward. First of all, we removed the community outreach chapter and the generic letters and tables. They will now be placed on the department's VI website shortly. I think the tables are already up there, tables and letters, and the outreach chapter, which was an excellent chapter, that was put together by Heather Schwartz. Unfortunately, we had to remove it, but it's going to be up on the website shortly. We combined data evaluation and compliance chapters. That's chapter 4, along with the multiple lines of evidence, which is chapter 5. It made the document flow a little better and reduced the number of pages. We removed all duplicate statements. The committee felt strongly that we needed to keep reminding people of certain points, and in the end we realized, no, they're intelligent people. If they read it once, they'll know it. So we removed all those duplicate comments. We properly tied in comments that say shall with the appropriate regulations. That was something that we hadn't done completely in the draft, but we corrected that. We revised the document to reflect the technical comments. And then finally, one of the biggest comments we got was the document was too big. So in the process of the revisions and removals, we pared it down from 275 pages to a measly 178 pages. Our instructors for today, again, my name is John Boyer. Sitting next to me is Scott Drew with GeoSynTech Consultants out of Ewing, New Jersey. And somewhere on the New Jersey Turnpike right now is Brian Blum. His excuse for not being here, he said, was he listened to sports radio this morning instead of traffic, and now he's paying for it. So so be it. Okay, at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Scott. He's going to be addressing the VI framework.
Good morning. Pleasure to be here. Glad everybody made it after the Oscars last night, and look forward to a very fruitful discussion here. So here's a diagram that shows the fundamental issue we're dealing with. We're concerned with the migration of contaminants of concern into an occupied space at concentrations that are of concern for human health. This is a pretty interesting area. It's been studied for about two decades, still relatively new in the world of environmental investigation. And there continues to be a lot of exciting research going on in this area, particularly in modeling, in sampling techniques, in mitigation strategies, and so forth. It's a very complex area of investigation, as John already mentioned. And just from this diagram, you can see a number of issues that are of concern here. You have all different types of buildings. You have industrial facilities. You have single-family homes with basements. You have single-family homes built on slabs. You have multiple family dwellings, apartment buildings, and so on and so forth. You also, beyond this, have issues with contaminants in indoor air that are present as background, as well as contaminants in outside air. So it's a very complex area of investigation. And I think that's reflected in the length of the document. I think the, by far the single greatest comment that we got during the review period was that the document was just too long. And even now at 178 pages, it's about the same size as the whole tech reg itself, which is an interesting comment. But I think that is because this area is so complex and so different from some of the other investigatory work that we do. And I think that is justified. Just a few words on the regulatory basis for doing vapor intrusion investigations. I think I confused people the last time we spoke when I suggested that the Brownfields Act includes a requirement to do vapor intrusion. I know a number of people searched the Brownfields Act legislation to look for the words.
Sorry about that, folks. You may have experienced a muted phase, but we're back on now, so we'll continue with the slide 13.
So vapor intrusion screening levels, this is one of the fundamental concepts of the regulations. These used to appear in the vapor intrusion guidance document. It does not appear in the vapor intrusion technical guidance document. It has been moved out. These tables are available on the website, on the vapor intrusion website, and the intention is to have these promulgated as regulations at some point in the future, which was the primary reason to have them removed from the guidance document itself. So again, you collect analytical data and compare it to these screening levels. There are three tables that are part of this. The first for groundwater screening levels, the second for soil grass screening levels, and the final for indoor air screening levels. And of course, the indoor air are broken into two categories, residential and non-residential. Table two in this area is contains the rapid action levels, which we'll talk about further, and table three gives some alternative screening levels for soil based on types of soils that might be encountered at a particular site. Next slide. So how are these screening levels developed? Well, the first is the use for the groundwater screening levels, the use of the venerable Johnson and Ettinger model, first developed in 1991, which is a mathematical model that uses a number of parameters, data collected from a site that predicts the concentration of vapors in indoor air from soil and groundwater. Note that you can't use these groundwater screening levels if the water table is within 2 feet of the bottom of the foundation or if the capillary fringe is in contact with the bottom of the building, under a building. And the reason for that is that the Johnson and Ettinger model is not valid for those situations. Another important point here is that there are no vapor intrusion screening levels for soil. There are for soil gas, but not for soil. There may be developed at some point in the future. At this point, the decision to conduct a vapor intrusion study based on concentrations of contaminants in the VADO zone is entirely up to professional judgment by the LSRP. Also note that non-residential standards do not apply to industrial facilities that are under OSHA. If there is an OSHA program in place, if there's monitoring, if there's a written plan, if information on health is available to the employees and so forth, that supersedes the screening levels for indoor air. And there are also a number of compounds that are on the screening list that do not have, that are on the TO15 list, excuse me, the analyte list, that do not have screening levels because of the lack of health data. An example would be trimethylbenzenes. And in that case, if you do have concentrations that are you think might be of concern, by all means, contact the department and see if some standards have been developed. Other screening levels, there's the rapid action level that I've already mentioned. These are important because they trigger the IEC for vapor intrusion. There are 100 times the cancer risk base for residential indoor air screening levels. These are in a separate table, and you'll note that there's only 13 compounds on that list at this time. A number of these other compounds will be added to it, and again, if you're in a situation where you have a high concentration of a compound present in indoor air that does not have a screening level, it's important to contact the department to get some guidance on how that might be handled. There are also some health department notification levels that vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but should be consulted as well. Excellent. It's important to consider this attenuation factor. This was actually used in development of the indoor air screening levels, but it's also something that needs to be considered when you look at the comparison of soil gas concentrations to indoor air concentrations. So this alpha shown here in this simple equation is just the comparison of the concentration in indoor air to the concentration in soil gas. And we expect to have a fairly high attenuation factor here, i.e. the concentrations in indoor air should be substantially less than in the soil gas. Why? Because of dilution factors, because of biodegradation in some cases, and a variety of different circumstances. So in this particular case, alpha is shown as 0.02, or roughly a difference of a factor of 50 between the concentration in subside of soil gas and indoor air. And again, this is the standard, or this is the approach that was used for developing this standard using this alpha of 0.02 compared to the soil gas screening levels. And certainly if you have a factor of greater than 50, you have to be concerned that you have a completed pathway between the soil gas and the indoor air. In addition, we have critical distance criteria in the technical guidance. Compound specific, and also gives you an idea of when you are required to do an investigation. For dissolved petroleum hydrocarbons, that critical distance is 30 feet. For other compounds, particularly chlorinated solvents, it's 100 feet, and for free product, it's also 100 feet. There are some exceptions to this, and particularly for petroleum products, and we'll talk about those when we discuss petroleum in specific. It's important to note that the critical distance criteria is applied to the edge of a groundwater plume. So you have to look at this distance 100 feet away. And it's also important to note that it's 100 feet either laterally or vertically. It's not acceptable to draw a right triangle, for example, and determine or calculate that the hypotenuse might be 100 feet away. if it's within 100 feet laterally, you're required to perform an investigation. So, and again, it's from that edge. The fact that you may have a well installed 90 feet away that is clean doesn't remove the responsibility for looking at that 100-foot criteria. So we put these together, and we get the triggers for doing vapor intrusion evaluation. And so you look at the combination of the screening levels for groundwater and that critical distance criteria. Look at concentrations for petroleum hydrocarbons within 30 feet of a building, for non-petroleum hydrocarbons within 100 feet and above the groundwater screening levels, and for free product also within 100 feet of a building. We also have the triggers, of course, for soil gas screening levels below the building, and I think you'll hear several times from us that we consider this the most important data to be collected during a vapor intrusion study, the subslab soil gas samples, and then finally the indoor air samples as well. There are other vapor intrusion triggers that are part of the technical requirements that need to be considered, including having a landfill that's either located on or adjacent to a site. Here the concern is the migration not only of methane from a landfill, but also of other chlorinated volatile organics that might be present in landfill gas and might be in a position to migrate, particularly if there's a substantial pressure difference between the gas pressure in the landfill and outside of the landfill. A wet basement or a sump with free product or detectable dissolved compounds is a trigger for doing a vapor intrusion study as well. Consideration of any potentially explosive methanogenic conditions that might be from other sources. You know, in California, that might be from, you know, petroleum reserves and so forth. Less likely here, but one case that I've seen in the past is fill over marine clays, for example, where a great deal of methanogenic activity may be producing substantial concentrations of methane. And then finally, there's a trigger for any other information that might impact, might indicate an impact on human health as well. Here's another term you're going to hear from us on a number of occasions during this presentation, and that's the multiple lines of evidence. I think that, you know, you may ask what we mean by multiple lines of evidence. I think the best analogy is to think about a conventional site investigation where you're doing investigation of soil contamination or groundwater. For example, if you place a groundwater well, you collect a sample, you analyze that sample, you compare it to a standard and so forth. There's a reasonable likelihood that when you go back to that well and collect another sample, you're going to get data that's similar to what you got. There are, obviously, you could have changes in the height of the water table, could have biodegradation going on and so forth, but there's a pretty direct connection between that one line of evidence and you're concerned about concentrations in groundwater. That doesn't really apply to vapor intrusion. There are so many other factors involved that taking an indoor air sample on one day and coming back and taking another indoor air sample isn't enough to make a judgment as to the impact from vapor intrusion. Some of those factors might be temperature, temporal patterns, you know, flow of air through a building, the HVAC system, cracks in the subsurface and so forth. And we'll get into those quite a bit more. Again, just to give you some background, that's what we're talking about when we talk about multiple lines of evidence. You need to collect a lot more data to make a judgment as to whether or not there's an impact. The other concept we'll talk about is the conceptual site model, which again applies to conventional investigations. We actually did not include the conceptual site model section in the VIG except to mention that it's important. It is not a deliverable. It's not something that's required as part of a vapor intrusion investigation, but is something that is highly recommended. There actually is additional guidance, a separate guidance document on the conceptual site model as well. So the key components of this include understanding what the source is, understanding what the pathways are in the vadose zone and in the groundwater, and understanding something about the building and its design, as well as the receptors that might be impacted. And this is a particularly valuable way to determine where you should be collecting your samples and what samples should be taken, and extremely helpful in interpreting the data that you receive. And finally, we'll talk about the several stages of the investigation of the VI pathway. Certainly the first stage is a receptor evaluation, which everybody's painfully aware of as the deadline looms on March 1st for the mandatory deadline on receptor evaluations. But then certainly moving to stage two for a VI investigation if a trigger has been implemented. Stage three, vapor intrusion mitigation, and John will spend some time talking about mitigation systems. And, of course, stage four, operation and maintenance, and finally, termination of that. We're trying in this training session here to try to give you some practical information and provide you with some examples of how these concepts are applied at particular sites, and John has an example of that for you now.
Thanks, Scott. This is an example, a reminder of what an LSRP can do if they so deem. In this case, we're talking about preemptive mitigation. You don't have to wait until you fully investigated a site to determine that, the obvious point sometimes is raised that we need to move to mitigation. And this is an example of that here. It's DuPont-Pompton Lakes in Pompton Lakes, New Jersey. The DuPont site, as you can see on the site map here, is at the top of the map. There is a groundwater plume area that extends from that site down to where Pompton Lake, the water body, actually is. We also have darker green areas on the side. These are the expanded investigation areas that were identified. So when we started the process of directing DuPont to conduct a vapor intrusion investigation, we had them start off by looking at two wells, one with fairly high levels and one with medium levels in groundwater. And you have to realize the levels that we found of principally PCE were only in single digits up to some double-digit results, parts per billion level. So they were above our criteria, but they weren't screaming results. But we were still concerned they were above our screening level. So we asked them to start off with this process just to get a handle because of the magnitude of what we were looking at. In this case, we directed them to collect 10 samples, five at each well, the subslab soil gas samples from the houses surrounding those wells. They were able to get access to seven of them. And you can see in this table here right now, these are the results that they got back from those seven houses. Mind you, there is 439 houses that potentially could be impacted. So after looking at the results for just those seven houses, DuPont informed us that they were not going to delay mitigation by conducting sampling at all the houses. That is their option, and one that we recommend, especially in cases like this. The time that would have been lost trying to investigate all those houses was deemed to be a waste, and instead they moved directly to mitigation. Based on seven of 439 houses. They were going to mitigate all those houses. So what we told them was that's acceptable, but there was a couple things we wanted them to do. First of all, we needed them to investigate that expanded investigation area, that buffer area, to make sure that based on the results they've gotten from groundwater, we can predict accurately what houses were going to be impacted. This added 71 buildings to the list that they needed to investigate. As it turned out, there was a number of houses that were outside of the plume area that were impacted, as much as 400 feet away from the edge of the plume. And that's one of the things you need to consider when doing any investigation. The structure does not have to be directly over the plume. Second, we asked them to collect subslab and indoor air samples from a representative number of structures. We wanted to make sure that our conceptual site model, which Scott just briefly discussed was indeed what was happening at the site. Were we certain that the pathway that the gases were traveling and entering the houses was indeed what we thought was happening? So they did conduct this investigation, and in fact, it supported the conceptual site model of what we thought was going on. Third, we wanted them to verify the limits of the groundwater contamination. It was fairly tight. They made it even tighter. And in the end, results matched up with what we had thought it was. We wanted to be absolutely certain. And then finally, they went ahead and installed the vapor mitigation systems. We're now over 450 houses that need to be mitigated. Unfortunately, we don't have it in all the houses yet. We've had a number of people refuse for various reasons to have a system put in, but we're still moving ahead. Okay, with that case study out of the way, we're going to move on to receptor evaluation. Now, receptor evaluation, we consider the first stage. This is a point at which you're looking at vapor intrusion. There was a trigger. As Scott mentioned, the series of triggers that are in the regulations, something that existed at a site that required you to do a receptor evaluation for vapor intrusion. So this is stage one. It's the initial gathering of information stage that you have. That work needs to be done within 60 days from the trigger for the receptor evaluation. It's the paperwork trail, more or less. The next step is on the receptor evaluation form or the report that's generated from that results. Now, there is a regulatory time frame, which is 1 year. There's also a mandatory time frame, which we're experiencing right now, and Scott mentioned, of 2 years. And that mandatory time frame is coming up March 1st of just in less than a week, well, a couple days.
Thursday.
So anyone who was already in the system, your time has come. For new discoveries, and the clock starts at that point. So what's involved in this first stage of receptor evaluation? Well, within 60 days, there are a number of things that you have to do. You have to identify buildings and subsurface utilities within 200 feet from the groundwater contamination or whatever the other trigger was that caused you to do a receptor evaluation. And for each of those buildings, there's certain information we need. We need to know its use. Is it a commercial, a residential? Is it a sensitive population that we recognize? We have to know its size, its characteristics, and any subsurface utilities that are associated with it. You should be able to establish groundwater flow to some extent and determine if free product is present. One of the things we struggled with within the committee was defining what a building was and then everything else. We had a good idea of what a building was, and we came up with a definition, as you can see here. It's your typical residential, commercial, retail, or industrial building. The difficult part was identifying those situations where it's not quite what we would define as a building. We gave it the title structure, and we defined it as a smaller construction that has limited access capabilities with minimal exposure potential to those individuals that may enter the structure for a much shorter period of time. Examples of these would include a shed, small pump house, or utility vault. Now, it's left to the LSRP whether they need to investigate that or not. I know growing up in Woodbury that a couple of municipal workers died when they went into a pump house. Weren't aware of methane building up in there, and they suffocated. That happens. So LSRPs have to judge each situation on an individual basis. Doesn't mean you necessarily apply the chronic levels to those situations, but you have to use professional judgments and not ignore structures when, in fact, they may be a source of exposure, unacceptable exposure. So use professional judgment on that. Preferential pathways. So what do we mean by preferential pathways? For the most part, what we're talking about is subsurface utilities, man-made utilities. It could be anthropogenic. We could end up with fractured bedrock. So for each site condition, you have to look at it individually. This is an opportunity for vapors to travel much further than we might normally expect them to travel. It enhances convective flow of the gases. So you need to be aware of large subsurface utilities, basement sumps, elevator shafts within buildings. Yes, elevator shafts are act as pistons that draw the contamination from the subsurface up to some of the top floors. You could have contamination somewhere around the 20th floor of a 40-story building and no other floors, just as a result of elevator shafts. So be aware of that. Models typically include or assume there's a certain level of convection going on with vapors. They assume that there's cracks in the buildings and that utility connections going into a building might are typical of every building, are not necessarily considered preferential pathways, but pathways nonetheless. One thing I want to clarify is in the guidance document, we make a distinction or a clarification from what the technical regs say, in that the regs currently say you have to identify all subsurface utilities and include their use, invert depth, diameter of the conduit, and the construction specifications. We're suggesting that an optional variance may be appropriate, so that for a typical residential house, every house has water, has gas, has electric, many of these in the subsurface that are running to buildings. Modeling already factors that in, assumes that buildings have those basic utilities. So for the most part, those are not ones that would have to be identified under this optional variance. However, when you have large lateral lines that service whole residential developments, large commercial buildings, mains servicing a series or a group of buildings, those are the ones that represent the greatest threat for preferential pathways. So if you see the picture there of the rather large pipe that's running down the street, I would be greatly concerned about that yellow house because vapors could travel quite a long distance in the backfill of that pipe and impact buildings nearby. So we're just trying to make you more aware of what constitutes a major concern with preferential pathways. The tech regs do not distinguish it. We're just trying to make you aware and suggest an optional variance for that. Iterative nature. The way vapor intrusion is investigated, particularly through the receptor evaluation phase, is you initially have a trigger. Say it's groundwater contamination. You don't have it fully delineated, but you know where the contamination is to some limited extent. Based on that, you identify buildings that need to be investigated. As time goes by, you tighten up the plume. You get a better idea of where it is. You may have additional buildings now that need to be investigated. That's the iterative nature of receptor evaluation. You have to go back. You have to start over again with new buildings. It doesn't mean everything comes to a stop. No, the initial buildings that were identified, they move forward through the time frames for completing receptor evaluations, investigations, mitigations. But you start over again with new buildings as more information becomes available. So you're constantly going back and re-examining things and expanding things as you need. At some point, you'll reach that point at which there are no additional buildings or structures that need to be investigated. But you have to be prepared for the iterative nature of the process. Okay, unoccupied buildings and vacant land. Now, not everybody comes up with a classic phrase that describes their business and thus will be able to ensure that they will always be open. Sometimes it's sort of a miss when they come out with something. The picture being an example, this is actually a very active restaurant, Salmonac restaurant in Seward, Alaska. But I love the phrase. But it just reminds you that sometimes you're going to have buildings that are not occupied. So what do you do with unoccupied buildings? Well, you still have to investigate it. You can't ignore it. You have to investigate it. It's unoccupied now. It may not be unoccupied tomorrow. If there is, if mitigation is required based on the investigation, mitigation has to be implemented. However, the form of mitigation could vary from what typically is associated with it. You may be looking at some form of institutional control such that when the building is going to be occupied in the future, that some work is done to mitigate the problem. That technically is still a mitigation. You're taking some action, but it may not be putting in a subslab depressurization system. Vacant land. Well, the technical regs do not address vacant land. It always ties it into buildings or structures. However, the reality is that vacant land might at some point in the future be utilized with structures or buildings being built on top of it. Is vapor intrusion a problem then? Absolutely. Right now, as vacant land, it probably isn't. So you need to be aware of that and address future use. That could involve investigation, although we don't require it. If that land in the future does become occupied, yes, you would be required to do an investigation. Now, for the most part, this is covered by CEAs and the biennial certifications that are submitted. There are provisions in there that state, is the remediation still effective at your within the limits of the CEA? If somebody decides to build on that land, well, the remediation is no longer effective, at least for that undeveloped or future to be developed land. Okay, let's move on to VI investigation, this is stage two. I'll pretend that I'm Brian speaking now and not stuck in a parking lot on the turnpike. Next. Just an overview of what we're going to cover. Conceptual site model. We'll go into a little more detail on what that is. We're going to go through the process of developing and implementing a VI investigation and the three subphases or stages of that: groundwater, soil gas, and indoor air. We'll talk about the time frames and then finally touch on what's the difference between a vapor concern and an immediate environmental concern. Conceptual site model. As the definition before stated that Scott gave you, it's just a basic picture of what's going on and how those vapors are moving. In this diagram, you can see some of the factors that weigh into vapors moving. You have dissolved contamination, in this case, in groundwater, moves through the vadose zone. It could be biodegradable. And you'll have an aerobic zone. You have the influence of the building itself drawing the contamination in. And then you have other factors that influence that advection into the building, such as stack effects and wind effects. Now, the next diagram we're going to go through in the next couple slides, some of the factors you need to consider in a conceptual site model. This diagram shows a particular case that Brian was involved in, where you're dealing with a fault line, fractured soil, and other issues, soil types, wells at different depths, understanding what's going on in the soil stratigraphy, what's going on in the subsurface influences the movement of vapors. So you have to be aware of that. On the next slide, you see you have to look at the surface. One more. And what the features are on the surface. In this case, you have residential buildings and their location relative to the groundwater contamination, the relative concentration of the contamination, surface features such as the blue thin line that's running through the zone B source can influence vapor movement, and you happen to have a highway adjacent to the site on the southwest corner of it. So these are some of the things you need to consider from a surface perspective. Okay, next slide. You also have to consider environmental factors. What chemical types are you dealing with versus the concentrations? Where is the source located? Groundwater conditions, soil conditions, weather, biodegradation, subsurface confining layers. All these influence the movement of vapors in the subsurface and have to be factored into that whole process. On the next slide, you see building conditions. What's the foundation type or the slab type? Are we a basement, slab on grade? Does the basement even have concrete or is it a dirt floor? Penetrations of the buildings, are they the standard penetrations or is there something more significant that vapors could more easily move through? Doesn't have an HVAC system, most of them do. Residential tend to move not as much air in the turnover. Commercial office buildings tend to have higher levels, restaurants the highest of all. Offices often have positive pressure in the buildings. So all these things deal with vapors as it relates to moving into the building. That influences what the risk and exposure is. Okay, that's enough on conceptual site model. Let's get into some of the pathway itself and the investigative process. Most investigations typically start with groundwater. That's where 95% of your cases, the source of the vapor intrusion is in groundwater. A couple of things we're going to be talking about, saturated zone features, acceptable uses of existing data, and collecting new data. Saturated zone features. Most important thing here is a clean water lens. You do experience that at times. If the groundwater contamination is at a deeper level, the vapors have a very difficult time moving through a clean water lens or a clean aquifer above it. It acts, in essence, as a barrier. Now, establishing whether you have a clean water lens, we use the criteria that you see here. If the clean water lens is somewhere between 3 and 6 feet, it might be just a matter of periodically monitoring to make sure that that lens is maintained, that it doesn't dry out in the summertime or whatever. If it's greater than 6 feet, for the most part, that would preclude any further investigation. You don't need to move on to soil gas. That clean water lens, wherever it exists, should act as a sufficient barrier to prevent the migration of vapors any further towards the surface. So understanding that, understanding the depth to water, the stratigraphy, and then the proximity of any preferential pathways. If you have a large utility line running through or quite near to the contaminated groundwater, that can influence the movement of vapors and even bypass a clean water lens. So be aware of that. Next slide is a cross-section of groundwater. Again, this is at a site that Brian was working on, and it shows the water table, shows which houses were impacted, and this is a reflection of different features that were occurring at the site. You could have houses right next to each other. One's impacted, one is not impacted based on whatever the issues are. And that's all part of the whole process of evaluating the site, developing a conceptual site model. Okay, on the next slide, we'll talk about groundwater, whether we're dealing with existing or new data. In this case, if you're dealing with existing data, for the most part, you can use that, assuming you have a properly constructed well, and you can use alternative groundwater sampling methods. You have to interpolate the data. When we say that you have to look 100 feet from the groundwater plume, we're not talking about an individual well. What we're talking about is interpolating the data and determining where's the limits of the groundwater contamination. So just looking at one well does not give you a lot of information. You really need to interpolate the results and from that determine roughly where the limits of the plume are. You can also use water supply wells, although that can be very difficult. They tend to be much deeper than we're concerned about for vapor intrusion. Now, if you're going with new data, ideally what we're looking for is a 10-foot screen across the upper saturated interval. Vertical profiles are great ways to get information, particularly if you're trying to establish a clean water lens. And in this case, we would recommend 0 to 3, 3 to 6, and 6 to 10 feet. Soil sampling. Well, obviously they collected soil samples on the moon, but it really didn't do us any good. And that's just emphasizing the nature of soil sampling and using those results for vapor intrusion. We do not have currently numbers for establishing when vapor intrusion is a problem based on soil results. That's left to the LSRP to interpret whether they think it is enough justification for a VI investigation. Clearly, if you have low levels that are 100 feet away, it's probably unlikely. However, if you have highly contaminated soil bordering on free product that's sitting right next to a house, even if there is no groundwater contamination, that might be a cause for doing a VI investigation. So use professional judgment and some common sense when it comes to soil results and whether that triggers a VI investigation. Soil gas sampling, this is stage 2B. Once you're done with groundwater contamination, you often move on to soil gas sampling. For the most part, we're looking for subslab, but you could also do near slab sampling, and the pictures just show a typical setup for those two. Soil gas sampling, as I said, subslab is what we prefer. It's the best indication of whether a building is potentially impacted by vapor intrusion. Doesn't mean you can always get it. You're going to run into problems with access sometimes. People don't want you drilling in their brand new basement that they just refinished. See if you can move to a closet, some area that's not as likely to be visual if you drill a small hole in it. You also might have a high water table that prevents you from collecting soil gas directly below it. All you'll collect is water. So there are factors that may prevent you from doing a subslab soil gas sample, but that's our preferred method under most circumstances. TO15 is a certified method that's typically used. You can use TO17, but we have found that TO15 is much easier and probably the vast majority of the people use TO15. You're allowed under the method to use either 1 liter or 6 liter canisters. The 1 liter, I think, is the more popular, takes less volume to fill, and yet you can still get your sample. Alternative methods are okay, but at this point, they should only be used for screening. We need to have a certified method to establish whether VI is a concern based on subslab soil gas samples. We're looking for the full parameter list. This is a point of contention sometimes with some people, but the department wants to see that initial full parameter list in order to determine whether we have a problem or we don't. It may be unrelated to the site, and we've identified quite a few other sites as a result of that process. And you also need to perform a leak check. Now, leak checks. The most common one is a helium shroud, and you can see that in the diagram. The blue Tupperware box is actually the shroud. It's filled with helium. You're looking for a target concentration of helium in that shroud of between 10 and 20%. you can collect the sample from the soil gas sample point and quickly analyze it in the field for helium. As long as you're less than 10% of the concentration within the shroud, you should be fine. Our main concern here is with dilution. Now, if you're confident after doing a series of these that everything is fine, you don't necessarily have to continue to do it, but our preference is that, in fact, you do. The other alternative, well, it's not really an alternative. If you're not going to do the helium shroud, then we really want you to do at least the shut-in test for the sampling train. Now, essentially, what a shut-in test is you're checking for leaks in the above-ground apparatus. So all the valves, the lines, the fittings, we want to make sure anything downstream of the probe is airtight. The easiest way to do this is once you have your apparatus set up, your sampling train, close the valves at either end, establish a vacuum within that, and simply monitor it for 1 minute. If the vacuum is maintained, then you know it's tight. And very simple, easy way to do that. This point, I think I'm going to pass it over to Brian. He has finally decided to show up. He's no longer listened to his sports radio station and, in fact, is here. And he made it out of the parking lot that is the New Jersey Turnpike.
Thank you.
So with that, Brian?
I'm sorry I'm late. Okay. The next slide, please. What we have here is this is table 3.1, if you're following along in the guidance document, and it's basically recommended density for sampling. And this recommended density was something that we discussed at length, the committee that put together the revised guidance document, and we felt it was necessary to have some guidance on the number of samples, up to 1,500, that's typically to represent like a residential setting. Now, there's lots of fine print that goes along with this. And next slide, please. So the fine print, this is footnoted right beneath the table in bullet form, actually. And when determining the exact number, a lot of factors come to play. Certainly, the subsurface of the building is important from like a foundation element, like where there may be different types of separations in the foundations by footers. Utilities come to play, where there may be the presence of sump pits, areas of great exposure. I'm not going to read off every one of those bullets, but there are a lot of factors that one should consider when determining the exact number and density of samples. Next slide, please. So when going into soil gas sampling, by far the most accepted method and what's encouraged is sub-slab sampling. That is what the guidance document speaks to, and that is basically the way to go. But under some circumstances, one may need to forego sub-slab sampling, and in those instances, near slab is acceptable. Typical examples of why you would go near slab as opposed to sub-slab, well, the first would be maybe homeowner refusal. If a homeowner recently did some extensive renovations, so they have flooring that they don't want compromised. Okay, and the second would be a water table within 2 feet of the slab. You don't want to poke a hole through a slab and have water right beneath it. But it is somewhat limited. It's not it's not as preferred as a sub-slab method in terms of your ability to evaluate data. Next slide. But if you are going near slab, you'd want to go about 5 feet below ground surface or as close to the water table as possible. You want to take two samples of the side of the building that's in question, and you would choose to be on the plume side of the building, if you will. And again, multiple lines of evidence. You want to use all the information that you have available to you for helping determine the location of where to put those samples. Next slide. Landfill gas. This is something that's a criteria now that could trigger a vapor intrusion evaluation other than the typical groundwater trigger. And this is in the tech regs. Next slide. So if this is the only thing that's triggering a vapor intrusion evaluation, the department recognizes that there may be a reason to seek variance for not having to do a vapor intrusion evaluation if it's just your only trigger. But certainly that the presence of landfills, one should recognize them and look at that from a concise conceptual model approach. So next slide. Okay. Now we're doing the sampling, and Appendix D, if you're following along, Appendix D has a sample questionnaire, and simply put, this is basically, from my perspective, it's two the most important things to get out of going into the home prior to doing the sampling is to determine where you can actually take your sample and also educate the owner. I say home, but it could be the building or whatever, wherever you're sampling. So there's like eight parts to it, and I'll just go over it quickly. The first part is like who lives there or who occupies the space. The second is the building characteristics. So you want to fill in like a little about the floor, what type of building it is, what kind of structure. It's more related to the structure itself. Three and four are outside and inside contamination sources. Certainly if you're sampling next to a gas station or a dry cleaner or where there's heavy traffic area, vehicle traffic, you'll want to note that. And certainly inside, there's a checklist of all these items that may be in the home that may impact or affect the quality of the sample to be taken. Number five is miscellaneous items. Typically under that, are you dealing with someone that's maybe a smoker, or do they extensively use dry cleaning?